and to proclaim your words. Let the word that I speak be as sharp as a two-edged sword, cutting deep into the hearts of these your children, that they may hear them and receive them. For as it was in the beginning, so it is now and always will be. A church that has no end. And the people of God say, amen. You notice on the bulletin, my theme for the message today, Abba, Father. That's the way Jesus said it, Abba, Father. And it's in the book of Romans, coming from the book of Romans, chapter 8. And I also want to say this, most of the time, I use members of my Bible study class to help lead the worship service, reading the scripture and the psalter and to serve as a leadership. You put in the extra effort to come and be a part of the study. So I want you to know I appreciate it. That's why I've been using most of you. Now there are some others that I did use, but I used most of the folks who participated in our Bible study class. In scripture, there are many different names used to describe God. While all the names of God are important in many ways, the name Abba Father is one of the most significant names of God in understanding how he relates to people. The word Abba is an Aramaic word that would most closely be translated as daddy. It was a common term that children would use to address their father. It signified a close, intimate relationship of a father to his child, as well as the childlike trust that a young child puts in his or her daddy. While most people, at least those who do not rationally deny the existence of God, would claim that we are all children of God. But the scripture reveals something quite different about its truth. We are all his creation and under his authority and lordship, and we will all be judged by him. But being a child of God and having the right to truly call him our Father is something that only a born-again Christian is able to do. We must understand that all people are created by God, but not all people are children of God. There is a difference in being created by God and being children of God. Becoming a child of God only happens when you are adopted by God through faith in Jesus Christ. This is important for understanding how and why God deals with us differently. If we are born again, we have been adopted into the family of God, redeemed from the curse of sin, and are joint heirs with Jesus Christ. Part of the new relationship is that God now deals with us differently, which includes his chastisement when we sin. Because of the new relationship, Christians may sin, but they cannot be comfortable or content living a life of habitual, ongoing sin. If people are living a life enslaved to sin and are comfortable in that sin and without the chastisement of God upon them, then we know they are illegitimate and not children of God. In other words, they are unbelievers. The misguided and most popular concept that all people are children of God and can truthfully call him our Father is simply not true. Now some of you may differ with me, but if we had some more Bible study time, we would get a little bit deeper into this. Just as children do not choose to be adopted, or chose who will adopt them, neither do Christians choose to become children of God, but instead, God chooses us. God chose us. We didn't choose him. He chose us. And while we were Christ to himself, according to the good pleasure of his will, having been chosen by God from before the foundation of the world. It is life-changing to understand the full force of what it means to be able to call the one true God our daddy, and what it means to be joint heirs with Jesus Christ. Because of our relationship with God, we know he no longer deals with us as enemies. Instead, we can approach a holy God as our heavenly Father with boldness and full assurance of faith. We have this confidence because of the indwelling presence of the Holy Spirit, who bears witness with our spirit that we are children of God, and if children, then heirs. Heirs of God and joint heirs with Christ. If indeed we suffer with him, then we are also glorified together. The benefit of being adopted children of God are many. There are many benefits to being an adopted child or children of God. Becoming a child of God is the highest privilege and honor that can be imagined. Because of it, we have a new relationship with God and a new standing before him. He deals with his children differently than he deals with the rest of the world. Being a child of God, adopted through faith in Jesus Christ, is the source for our hope, the security of our future, and the motivation to walk worthy of the calling with which we are called. You see, we can't do anything on our own. We can only do what God allows us to do. I don't care how long you've been on your faith journey. I don't care how long you seek out your soul salvation. And unless the Holy Spirit of the Almighty God dwells in you, you are
nothing. Come on, man.
You do not have life. You are just existing. But what is it to just exist and not have life? Have you gone to some of these nursing homes and some of the hospital rooms and you see people there? They are alive. They got life. They're just existing. There's no quality of life. And if you can be in similar form in your religious faith and belief, we are alive, but we don't have life. We're just existing without the adoption of the Holy Spirit and the faith through Jesus Christ. Then we are not truly children of God. We are created by God, but if we haven't been adopted and have accepted the adoption, then we are not children of God. This might be a little hard to understand. But the relationship between God and us goes both ways. See, God is already God. He has already created us. He wants to adopt us. But the only way God can adopt us to be his children is through Jesus Christ. And if we fail to accept Jesus Christ as our Lord and Savior, we cannot be adopted by God. That's the point I'm trying to make. And everybody does not accept Jesus Christ as Lord of Lords and King of Kings. We must acknowledge him to be who he is. And we mean the sooner we accept him and acknowledge him to be our Lord and Savior, then we can become adopted and become children of God. Because without the adoption, we are just God's creation. But with the adoption, we are God's children. It makes a difference. Because of the relationship, because of our relationship with God, we know he no longer deals with us as enemies, but instead we can approach our holy God as our heavenly Father with boldness and full assurance. We have this assurance because of the indwelling presence of the Holy Spirit, who bears witness with our spirit that we are children of God. And if children, then heirs of God, joint heirs with Christ, If indeed we suffer with him, then we also may also be glorified with him. That's a great benefit of being a child of God. As we come to understand the true nature of God, as revealed in the scripture, we should be amazed that he not only allow us, but even encourage us to call him our Father. When you got up this morning and you said your prayers, who did you pray to? Did you say, our Father? If he is your Father, then you have to have been adopted. And the only way you could have been adopted is to accept Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior. If not, you're just one of God's creation. It is amazing, my friends. It is so amazing that holy and righteous God, who created and sustained all things, who is all powerful, all-knowing, ever-present God, would allow a sinful human being to call him Daddy. How do you come to understand this reality? It is how sinful and how sinful we might be. The privilege of being able to call him our Father will take on a whole new meaning for us and help us to understand God's amazing grace. The word Abba has never been translated. A-B-B-A was not translated. And I'm told it wasn't translated because the translator of the King James Version had a great reverence for the word of God. And that word did not need to be translated because he is our Father. When they came to the word Abba, they didn't dare translate it into English because it was such an intimate word. It could be translated as to say, Daddy. And God, the Almighty God, is more to us than just a daddy. He's a father. And there's a difference between a daddy and a father. And I'm going to say a little bit about that and I'm done. God is our Heavenly Father. But I wouldn't hesitate to go around calling him Daddy. Wherefore, we are more a servant, but a sons. And if a son, then we are heirs of God through Jesus Christ. The Spirit therefore gives us an experience of being a son of God, whereby we can cry out, not just saying the word or putting on a false pride, and call God our Father. Because the Spirit is bearing witness with our spirit. This gives us the experience of being a child of God. And as I said earlier, if you have accepted Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, and committed your life to him, you are an adopted child of Almighty God. And you should be proud to go around and tell the world that God is your Father. Do you not know there are some folks who don't acknowledge God? There are some folks who do not acknowledge Jesus Christ to be God's Son? They are just created by God. They cannot be children of God. Because the only way you can be a child or children of God is to be adopted through the faith of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. The best father is the one who knows God as his heavenly Father. Only Jesus Christ can provide that relationship. There are some men here, and I'm talking about us now, there are some men here with us today that have taken on the responsibility as father with no biological connection, no DNA at all. While there are other men with the DNA and all the biological right, but fail to take on the responsibility of a father. There is a difference. There is a difference. Being a sperm donor say that again. So you may not know my term, but it's legal. And it's politically correct. Being a sperm donor does not constitute or make a man a father. There are a lot of donors out there that have to be forced by the court to pay child support. Can you really call them fathers? No, no, and no. You can't. He is just your baby's daddy. And there's a lot of baby's daddy out there in the world. Some of them come to church every Sunday. They're just the baby's daddy. In order to be a father, you've got to take on the whole responsibility of providing and making provision for the child in order to be a father. And until you take on the whole responsibility to provide for that child, you're just the baby's daddy. Now some of you may not like that term either. But it is politically correct. If the court have to make you buy some food and some pampers, a little bit of milk once in a while, and a pair of sneakers, you ain't no father. You're just a baby's daddy. And I can say this, and if you don't like it, I ain't gonna be here next Sunday. But is this true? To be a father, you must take on the full responsibility to provide and care for the child or the children. That means more than bringing home a paycheck, paying the mortgage, paying the light bill, and buying a little bit of groceries sometime. It means being there for and with your child or children in every aspect of their lives, showing up at their schools for teacher-parent conference, talking with the teachers, find out how you can help to make your child a better student. When was the last you took the time to do that? I know some of you young fathers or young daddies or whichever category you fall in have to go to work. I understand that. But I declare, you have to take a little bit of time at some point in your life to go check on your child at the schoolhouse.
Amen.
Be a man. Take on the responsibility of a father. Provide, protect, love your children. Someone shared with me about, I think I mentioned it to somebody about 3 weeks ago. It was the week before conference. I was having my car washed because I was going down in your conference. You know, you go to conference, your car clean. Right. If your car ain't clean, you ain't getting no good salary. I was having my car clean before I went to conference. And a young lady was working at the car wash. And she shared with me about one of her classmates. She's only 25 years old. She shared with me about one of her classmates who had a job for one of their classmates. And he would do nothing for the job. Nothing. Well, a young man, 17 years old, bought the child some pampers. And when the father, no, when the daddy or the sperm donor heard about what this killing dad, he wouldn't provide for the child. Someone else provided a packet of pampers, and he killed the guy dead. Now he's going to jail for the rest of his life.
That's right.
Who are you going to provide for the child? That's a true story. It happened in Hartsville, South Carolina. Something wrong with some of our young men. And some of them being so young. We need to take a look at ourselves, examine ourselves. Is God satisfied in me? Am I the man that God called me to be or created me to be? Now I know, brothers, you can't be with your children 24/7. I know that. That's why God is there. And you need that relationship with Jesus Christ. Because see, God and Jesus are going to do far more than you can ever do for your child or for your children. But when there's that relationship between you, God, and Jesus, it makes it so much better for your child or children. If you don't have a relationship with Jesus Christ, then you are not a child of God. God just created you. You must have that relationship. So you can call him Father. And if you have that relationship, then you need to take on the responsibility and live up to be a father to your children. They're just there at the house, going through the motion. And when the child grew up, make something out of themselves, being a productive citizen with a little bit of notoriety, yeah, they come with their chest push out.
A big wide grin on their face.
That's my child. That's something. Where were you? When a child is struggling, get through school, where were you? Where were you? When the child was going through the struggle to get to where they are now, where were you? Where were you when they needed you just to be there urging them on with a smile? Be a father to him. All you have to do to be a father is to take on the ultimate responsibility. And we got some men who have taken on the ultimate responsibility without any DNA, who make some real good fathers.
Amen.
I'm going to close with this little song. It's by the Winstons, some of you heard it. And it's called, I'll Call Him Father. Mm-hmm. And these are the words of the song. There's a man at my house, he is so big and strong. He goes to work each day, stay all day long. He comes home each night looking tired and beat. He sits down at the dinner table and has a bite to eat. Never a frown, always a smile. When he says to me, how is my child? I've been studying hard all day in school, trying to understand the golden rule. He says, education is the thing if you want to compete. Because without it, son, life ain't very sweet. I love this man, and I don't know why, except I'll need his strength until the day I die. My mother loves him, and I can tell by the way she looks at him when he holds my little sister Nell. I hear her say just the other day that if it hadn't been for him, she wouldn't have found her way. My real old man got killed in the war, and she and 7 kids couldn't get very far. She said she thought that she could never love again. And then there he stood with that big wide grin. He married my mother and he took us in. And now we belong to the man with the big wide grin. I think I'll call this man father. I'll call him love. I'll call him father. Because that's what father is all about. Do you know anybody like that? You don't have to be father with the DNA. You can be father with the love and the ultimate responsibility. Because that's what fatherhood is all about. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Happy Father's Day.